The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Welcome to Pilgrim's Progress. I'm Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. This Psalm 23, always a favorite of mine, it talks about the experience of a shepherd boy. That shepherd boy understood that sheep, if allowed to remain in a pasture, would utterly destroy it. They would eat the grass down, and then they would pull the grass up by the roots until finally you have a barren place. So the only way that he could get them to lie down in a green pasture is if their bellies were full, if they were content. They had had everything they wanted to eat. And then he says, He leads me beside quiet waters. Sheep are afraid of running water. And so the shepherd would dam up the little stream, make a pool of quiet water, and there the sheep would drink. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. In other words, when we belong to Jesus, he is our shepherd. There are wolves, and there is a shepherd. Most who try to guide you today will be wolves. I'm interested in a shepherd. I want to be an under-shepherd, not a under-wolf, but an under-shepherd. One who will make a way for you to walk close with Jesus. There's only one reason why you should be listening to this broadcast today. And that's because there is a hunger in your heart for Jesus Christ. There is an interest in your soul, in your spiritual well-being. Either you recognize that you need a shepherd in your life, someone who will prepare the way ahead of you, someone who will provide quiet water where your fears will not be aroused. Someone who will provide plenty of food that you could be strengthened and walk with courage. Have you ever seen a man who absolutely comes to an end of himself, filled with rage and bitterness? He's been treated poorly by every person he's ever known. He tries to talk about it, and he's shunned. They think he's crazy. You recognize at all what I'm talking about? When we come to an end of all human ability, they used to call it a nervous breakdown. I don't know what they call it today. It's a place where people finally escape to because life is simply too heavy for them, and they can't bear the burden one more hour. Now, instead of having a nervous breakdown, people have a beer, or they watch television, or they go to pornography, or they go to some other means where they can comfort their soul with darkness. or they just go and work harder. But finally, the time comes when you know you can't work hard enough to meet the demands, and finally you just crash. I've seen men many times, filled with bitterness, who come to an utter end of their lives. They commit suicide. This last Christmas, a man I've known for many years was so despondent, didn't believe that his wife loved him anymore. Life wasn't treating him the way he thought it should. He was an elderly man, bitter of heart, broken of spirit, and finally put a gun to his head and pulled the trigger. There's another way. It's the way of following the shepherd. I know another man. He's worked all of his life trying to gain riches. He's tried a number of business ventures. He's held some very respectable jobs. But he never was able to gain the wealth that he desired. And so now his attitude is one of surly indifference. Oh, it doesn't matter. Life doesn't matter. I'll do what I want to do. I'm a tough guy. He's gruff and rough. That's what happens to a man who follows his own path, follows his own course, and then is finally disappointed when he sees that it doesn't lead where he wanted it to lead. I want to tell you a secret of my heart today. I made a decision a long time ago that I was going to follow Jesus Christ. And it didn't matter where that path led, but I was going to follow him. Because I knew in the end that path would lead me to what John Bunyan calls the celestial city. And I made a determination in my heart that I was not going to pursue the things that this world considers success. Now, I'm not judging any of you. I'm simply telling you the decision that I made. And the decision that I made is that I would not be interested and I would not pursue a place in this world. That I was not going to seek and search after career advancement. That I was not going to save my money for retirement. It didn't matter if I had a car or not. If I drive an old car, it doesn't matter. It's simply a matter of how does God want me to get from point A to point B. Now, I have to confess, when I was a young man, I came out of seminary with enough money because I went to seminary under full scholarship and then worked while I was in seminary. So I left seminary driving a brand new Mercedes-Benz. And for the next 10 years, I drove that Mercedes-Benz and every other year, I got a new Mercedes-Benz. And my Mercedes-Benz were all paid for with cash. I wanted to be successful. And I was successful. I, as a young man in my 20s, traveled a lot, spoke in universities and colleges, lectured, had many, many opportunities, and I grabbed every one of them to make a name for myself, to be successful. I was driven. And then Jesus came. And I saw that I had a choice. I could build the name of Ray Greenlee and try to make myself something. Or I could build the kingdom of God and make of myself nothing. I chose to walk in the narrow path. I wanted to go to the celestial city. And so today I spend my time praying, reading the scriptures, preaching, teaching, counseling, confronting sin, even as I do on this radio broadcast. That's how I spend my time. All of my time, all of my money, they are for the journey. And in the process, to take as many of you with me as I can possibly take as I travel through this world to the one that is coming. The cry of my heart is that you would be saved. It's not about being somebody or being something any longer. It's about building the kingdom of God. And so I come confronting sin, calling you to be entirely sanctified, telling you the good news that you can be made whole in Christ, that there's no logical reason for any sin that might come into your heart. It is simply of the enemy and must be cut off and cast out. Am I saved? Yes, I know in my spirit and in my heart that I'm a saved man. How do I know that? Because I believe the promises of God, and I don't walk in unbelief or sin before Him. I walk clean by His grace, and when I do sin, I quickly repent, and I turn from it, and I cast it out of my life in the name of Jesus. Because I'm on my way to that celestial city. Now, most of you today will have a day full of activity. I pray that that activity is given to you by Jesus, that He is ordering your steps, and that it is not yourself trying to take care of yourself and build yourself your kingdom. I pray today that in your heart you are only interested in building the kingdom of heaven. Now, in this 23rd Psalm, listen as I share this. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. The rod, of course, is for the punishment of God. If you want to see where it's spoken of in scriptures, look at the 12th chapter of the book of Hebrews, where it speaks about the punishment of God that He inflicts on His people. He takes us to the woodshed. Today we have a very popular belief that whippings are wrong, that we should not spank children. That's the philosophy of the world, and we are reaping the harvest of that wickedness. Many times as a child, I felt a bite of a strap, and it trained me in righteousness. Now, I'm not talking about abuse. I'm talking about a measured response to deal with the sin of a child. In Hebrews, the 12th chapter, we're told that Jesus administers that whipping to us to deal with our sin, that we would no longer walk in it. David is saying, I am comforted by the punishments of God and by your staff, which is the crook which He reaches down and pulls us out of places that we fall into where we're hurt. So it's a rescuing staff and it's a punishing rod. He says, these two things comfort me. Now, when I look at this in the context of Psalm 23, it's very clear that I will walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Now, when we look at Bunyan's story, the allegory that he published for the first time in 1678, this old story, he is very clear that you must go through this valley of Baca, as the scripture refers to it, this place of weeping, or this place of utter darkness, of trial. Now, frankly, when you read Bunyan on this story, as I'm going to do for you, the Valley of Humiliation, where he met Apollyon, was a much easier battle than the battle in the Valley of the Shadow of Death. I feel like I leave the Valley of Humility only to walk into the Valley of the Shadow of Death, and then I seem to go right back through the Valley of Humility and then back into the Valley of the Shadow of Death. That seems to be where I've lived for quite some time. In the allegory, it happens rather quickly, just a short day, and he's through. But in reality, in the life of a Christian, it often takes much longer to transit these places. It may take 7 or 8 years to get through a valley of humility, as God deals to the very bottom of our hearts, so that no longer is there a spirit of grumbling or complaining. No longer is there a spirit of bitterness or anger. He deals to the bottom with us. So I don't know what you're in. Are you rejoicing in that green field where you have plenty to eat and everything is comfortable and you're a happy camper? Or are you journeying through the valley of humility, or through the valley of the shadow of death, where you don't know if you will survive? Right now, I'm traveling through a valley of humility and the valley of the shadow of death all at the same time. I'll be honest. The house that I'm living in is being sold. That means I have to move. The valley of humiliation is not having the resources to make that move possible, and yet I have to move. So how does that work? So I'm before the Lord, humble of heart, crying out to him, asking him to show me the way through. This may be a rod application for me, or it may be the staff application that he's going to use for me. But it is the valley of humiliation. What do I mean? Well, when we can't take care of ourselves and we have nowhere to turn but to Jesus, that humiliates the human flesh. And God loves to humiliate the human flesh. He wants us to depend on him and him alone. And he wants all words of complaint to be removed from our hearts. It's so easy for someone at work to begin to feel like they're not being treated fairly, and grumbling begin to emerge from their hearts. All of us have done it. Jesus uses the rod on our backs when we do that. He begins to punish us. Remember, my dad used to say to me, I didn't like something and I'd begin to cry as a little boy. And my dad was a big guy, and he would say to me, Raymond, if you're going to cry, I'm going to give you something to cry about. Well, I knew what that meant. That meant spanking was coming. I needed to get out of my bad mood and get out of my feeling sorry for myself and get out of being a victim and deal with reality. I didn't like it then, but you know what? I love my dear father, who's passed now to Jesus. I love him for that integrity that he demonstrated and the manliness that he taught me. So I'm going through that, and then with the radio, this is a very difficult time for me because I've always said I don't want to talk about money on the radio, and yet I don't want that to be a point of pride. The reality is, last month the radio didn't pay for itself. We're still very short of being able to meet the demand for the radio. I went to the post office this morning, as I always do, looking for your letters, looking for your support, and there was a letter there. I want to read it to you. It says, Pastor Ray, it's a blessing to be enabled to give. It's a blessing to be enabled to give. To have provision to join in the journey to the celestial city, a fellow pilgrim and brother. And enclosed was a $100 bill. No name, except the name that is most important, fellow pilgrim and brother. I treasure that letter. It lifted my heart and lifted my spirit. I know that for me to remain on the radio, there's going to have to be a great outpouring of tithes and offerings to support this radio ministry. I don't like telling you that. That humbles my heart. For some years, I've simply gone to the Lord and prayed, and then the Lord rebuked me and said, at the church, we have an offertory. At the church, part of the worship is to give. Don't deny those dear brothers and sisters who love you and whom you love. Don't deny them the right and the privilege to join you in the journey toward the celestial city by opening their hearts and giving hilariously to support the work of this radio broadcast. I'm here with you 5 days a week, proclaiming the Word of God, being honest and pouring out my heart. You need also to have an opportunity to pour out your heart, to respond and say thank you to Jesus. It's not me. It doesn't come to me. It goes to Jesus. And so I'm inviting you today to make a decision. Do you want your heart turned toward Jesus by the kind of teaching that this radio ministry brings to you day by day? Is it of value to you? I spoke with a man last night. He has been listening from the very first time I went on the air back in the 90s. It's interesting, though, I've never heard from him before. I wonder how many of you have been listening for some time, but I've never heard from you, either by phone call or by letter. Well, I need to hear from you. I need to hear from your heart. Of what value is this radio ministry to you? Give in proportion to the value of this ministry to you. So let me give you our mailing address, and I'd like to hear from you this week. It's National Prayer Chapel, three words, National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. I'm not going to collect your addresses. I'm not going to send fundraising letters. I'm not going to sell you anything. I'm not going to bribe you by saying, I'll give you three CDs if you'll... No, go to the webpage and download free anything you'd like to download. This is not a business for me. This is the work of preaching the gospel. And the people of God need to have an opportunity to have the offering plate passed, and they need to have an opportunity to give as a demonstration of their gratitude toward God for what they have been receiving. So the address is the National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. Part of why I've been so shy of even talking about money or resources is that it seems like every ministry duns people for ministry or duns people for money, selling this and selling that. I don't want to go there. For me, your giving is not something for which you should receive some gift for. You are receiving every day, 5 days a week, the gift of Jesus Christ, the gift of confrontation over your sin, the gift of being taught the scriptures in an unvarnished way. You are receiving the gift of your salvation. Many of you have had your lives transformed by this ministry, but you have never given one penny. And I just hear the Lord saying, I need to give you an opportunity to make that right and to demonstrate the love that you have for Jesus and for this straight testimony of his gospel. So it's the National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. I also want to give you the telephone number here in studio. It's 877-534-0780. I would enjoy talking with you if you recognize that you have been walking in sin before God, or you're in the midst of the valley of humility, or in the midst of the valley of the shadow of death, and you want me to pray with you. I'll join you as a brother in the midst of the valley, and we'll pray together. That's why this radio broadcast is here, to strengthen and encourage and pray for one another in this journey toward the celestial city. That's where we're headed. We're on our way to heaven. So our phone number is 877-534-0780. I also want to thank those of you who have called and talked with me personally off air. That phone number is 703-489-1785. That's my personal cell number. One brother called me, he's a taxi driver downtown in Washington, D.C. He was such an encouragement to talk to. Thank you, my brother. I love you in the Lord. He listens every day. Well, let's turn now to the story. We're going to begin in a chapter entitled A Fierce Battle and a Dark Valley. I'm sharing this from an edited version of Pilgrim's Progress by C.J. Lovick, and I'm also reading it with his permission, because it is copyrighted material. Now, at the end of the Valley of Humiliation, there was another valley, the Valley of the Shadow of Death. And since there is no other way to the celestial city, Christian was obligated to go through it. So Bunyan believed that the normal course of a Christian's life will take him through the Valley of the Shadow of Death. This is not an optional side tour. This is what you must go through if you are going to reach the celestial city. The narrow path leads right down through it. Now, this valley was a very solitary place, as the prophet Jeremiah describes it, a wilderness, a land of desert, of pits, a land of drought, and of the shadow of death, a land that no man but a Christian passed through, where no one lived. Now here, Christian was to be afflicted more than in his fight with Apollyon, as the following adventure will show you. When Christian came to the borders of the Valley of the Shadow of Death, I saw in my dream that he met two men coming toward him. children of those men who brought an evil report concerning the land of Canaan. These two men were quickly retreating when Christian stopped them and asked where they were going. They said, "Back! Back! We're going back! We would advise you to do the same. If you have any concern for your life or your peace of mind." "Why, what's the matter?" inquired Christian. "Matter," they said. "We were going the same way that you are now going, and we went as far as we dared go, and almost went past the point of no return. Had we continued, we would not be here to warn you." "Why?" "We were almost in the valley of the shadow of death. But as our good fortune would have it, we looked ahead and saw the danger before we came to it." "Well, what did you see?" "See," they said, "why, the valley itself is black as pitch. Yet we also saw demons and dragons of the pit. We also heard in the valley a continual howling and yelling that sounded like people in unutterable misery and pain who are bound to affliction and irons. And over the valley hangs the discouraging clouds of confusion. Death also spreads his wings over it. In a word, it is dreadful and completely unruly." Then Christian said, "All these terrors aside, nothing that you've said so far convinces me that there's anything but the way to the celestial city." "Well, you have your own way, but we will not choose that way for ourselves." And so they parted. Well, this is right. We begin our Christian walk. We receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. We begin to experience the wondrous mercy of Jesus. The peace of God comes into our hearts as we repent of our sin. We walk clean before God. There's no reason even for the brand new Christian to walk in sin. All the power of sin is broken by the Spirit of God. We're washed in the blood. We're victorious in Jesus. We're filled with the Holy Spirit. But the valley of the shadow of death is coming. Many are happy to receive the first part of the gift of salvation, but most flee from the second. You see, there is a rod and a staff. There is a rescuing that Jesus does for us from the depths of our sin. But then there is a punishment and discipline as he takes us through the valley of the shadow of death, where we fear even for our lives. Do you fear for your life today, or are you living a life of ease? Have you taken some shortcut so that you would not have to go through the valley of the shadow of death? Are there things in your life that you're simply avoiding dealing with? You want to keep the peace at home and not talk about Jesus? You don't want to live as a Jesus Christ person before the world? Those at work don't even know you're a Christian. Have you been careful to avoid offense with the gospel of Jesus? I know. We've all done it. But the time comes when we have to say, am I a Christian or am I not a Christian? I am eager for the day when every man and every woman will have to clearly declare, I am a follower of Jesus Christ, or I am not a follower of Jesus Christ. I am sick and tired of the gray area, the in-between place where people can slide over and play with the world, or they can slide over and hang with God. I'm sick of it. I don't want it anymore. I am disgusted by people and churches who have invited the world into their hearts, who engage in all of the things of the flesh. I'm sick and tired of it. I'm sick and tired of people who who call themselves Christians. I'm sick and tired of it when they go and dive into the world. I mean, it's simply wrong. It's simply wrong. We can't go there. I just received a text. It says, "Please know I'm giving for the radio broadcast joyously and sacrificially. My physical attacks are more, at this point, almost more than I can carry myself. The battle that you and I, as well as our brothers and sisters, are going through is physically affecting every minute of my life. I continue to pray for his strength to endure this current trial. My heart breaks that I can't find deliverance for my husband's heart. I feel I cannot go any further in my faith. I am so sorry my faith is weak at this point." This is a dear sister that sent a very generous check last week. She is giving sacrificially. It was the widow's mite. She lives in another state. In fact, she lives in Pennsylvania. But she listens every day. Every day she's there at her computer and she's listening. But she's at an end, as I'm describing. And I'll tell you, when we come to the end of everything, when we're in the valley of the shadow of death and it looks like we will not make it through, remember that Psalm 23 promise that it's both a rod to punish, but it is also a staff to rescue us. And I want to say to this dear sister, Jesus will rescue you. Trust in him. Lift up your head. Rejoice in him. In the midst of your trial and tribulation, rejoice in him. Now, our phone number is 877-534-0780. Tom, welcome. What would you like to share today?
Hey, Pastor Ray. Christian greetings, Brother Tom.
Thank you.
I just want to give you a quick call. I really haven't heard today's broadcast. I'm out of pocket, but I was listening yesterday for a good portion of it and just wanted to rejoice with you for all the men that were called. Just wanted to praise the Lord for that because we need each other.
You know, yes.
As iron sharpens iron, so does one man sharpen the wit of another.
Yes.
And if we're not together, it makes it that much easier for the enemy to pluck us off.
And it means being very honest and vulnerable with one another with no hidden agendas. Being very clear that our journey is not to success in this world, but to success in the next world.
Isn't that the truth? And every day that becomes truer, I think, because you know that's one day less that we have here on this earth, and one day closer we are to meeting the Lord, whatever day that may be, you know, the next breath may
yes.
be our last. We don't know.
And we have to make a decision, Brother Tom, about whether or not we'll use the resources we have for our own ease and comfort in this world as though we were living in this place and citizens of this place instead of investing in the kingdom of God and building up the work of the gospel.
Yes. Amen. Lay up where moth and rust is not corrupt. Amen.
And we have even believed this lie that we should just give 10% and then we're covered. But that's not true. Everything we possess belongs to our Savior on this journey. Everything has been provided for Him. And if we're selfish with that, His blessing will be removed from us.
Yes. Yes. Amen. I hear what you're saying. And I like what you said yesterday about George Whitefield and John Wesley, too. That was really good. That was...
I've read the letters that they exchanged.
Oh, wow.
And there was a real attempt to create animosity to turn one brother against another brother, and they finally got together and spoke one-on-one and settled that they would give themselves totally and completely to preaching against sin, calling men and women to follow after Jesus Christ, and that the incidental differences didn't matter. They were following Jesus.
Well, it was kind of like two sides of the same coin, almost.
Yes. Because frankly, there is an eternal security for the eternally faithful.
Yeah.
And if you're not eternally faithful, you're not saved.
Yes.
And that's what my dear brother yesterday was saying.
Yeah, no, I agree. I agree with both of you, actually. If you can, you know.
Absolutely.
Anyway, I just want to tell you, I appreciate you, and I love you, and I pray for you, and I know the Lord's going to meet your needs. I'm not a very good vessel for him to meet him through, but I will be sending you a widower's mite, so to speak, and I'm sure the Lord's going to increase me. I've been down in the valley long enough in that sense. I believe I'm coming out in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The devil is a liar.
He is a liar.
Amen, and God's going to make it known.
And you know what, Tom? I don't care about the size of an offering. I care about the heart that treasures the Word of God and says, I want to be a part of making something happen for the city of Washington, D.C.
Amen.
And people say to me many times, Pastor, I don't hear anybody else on the radio talking the way you talk. Well,
right.
It's not me. It's the gospel of Jesus you're not hearing.
Yes.
And when you hear the real gospel, you're convicted of your sin. And that widow's mite is being given to Jesus to say, I'm yours, Jesus.
Yes.
And I rejoice in that.
Yeah, well, the Lord's going to multiply it.
Absolutely.
He is the God of the increase. I know that's right.
Yes, he is, Tom.
I found that once or twice in my Bible.
Yes. Tom, God bless you. Good to hear from you.
You too, Pastor Rick. Thank you.
Yep. 877-534-0780. We will go through this valley of the shadow of death. And my dear sister in Pennsylvania is going through that. And as I just think about it right now, I want to pray for her. And would you join me? Lord, my dear sister has just texted us saying that she doesn't have the strength to go any further, that she's gone as far as she can go, and her heart is crying out for her husband and her family. Lord, I pray that you will sustain her with your promises and your word. I pray, Lord, that all of self will be washed away, and that she will experience right now, as she's listening to this broadcast, the joy and the peace that only comes from you, Jesus. I pray for the full physical healing in her body. Lord, you know that we can only bear so much in this human frame. And you said you would never test us beyond what we could endure. So, Lord, I stand by faith for my sister today and for my brother Tom, and for many who are listening to this broadcast, Lord, don't let us be cast down. Don't let us believe the devil's lies in the midst of this valley of the shadow of death. Lord, even if I perish, I will serve you. I will worship you on the other side. Lord, I praise you and I honor your name. And I say glory, glory, glory to the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. 877-534-0780. I would guess that some of you feel the same way my dear sister in Pennsylvania feels, that you don't have any strength to go on. If you're out of strength and you can't go any further, one of the things that I always say is please check if any strength from Jesus is draining away. And what will drain away the strength of Jesus from your heart is any bitterness or any unforgiveness that remains in your spirit. The first step to blocking the devil is to forgive your brothers and sisters, your mother and your father, to forgive those workmates, to forgive those bosses. I could go back through a whole litany of people who've treated me utterly unfairly and have stolen thousands and thousands of dollars from me. One church, denomination. They stole from me $16,000. When I confronted the president of that denomination, he said to me, "So sue us." And I turned in sorrow and left, because I knew I could never sue someone claiming the name of Jesus. I would rather lose the money than to shame the name of Christ before the world. I had to forgive that man and that denomination. I had to forgive them. I couldn't allow bitterness to remain in my heart, because it stood as a block between me and God. So if you're feeling exhausted and weary in the journey and you can't go any further, just check and make sure that there's no unforgiveness in your spirit. Make certain that you're clean before God. And then lift up your head and rejoice and claim His strength, and it'll begin to flow into you again. Do you remember when King David had gone to fight against Israel with the Philistines? And the Philistines said, "We can't let this man come. He'll turn on us and destroy us." And so they sent he and his men back to Ziklag. And when they got there, they discovered that Ziklag had been burned and their wives and their children had all been stolen and everything they owned had been taken. Everyone was so exhausted, so strung out, they just wept. These grown men, these tough soldiers wept. They talked about stoning David. That was where they thought their solace would come from, revenge. But the scriptures say David went to the Lord and found strength in the Lord. Strength does not come from revenge, it comes from the Lord. Hi, welcome. What would you like to share?
My name is Rocco Ray. I've been listening to you. You're a wonderful person, and you keep me going half the time.
Good.
Well, I have my ups and downs, of course. I heard about your beautiful church. I saw it a long distance, but I'm not there yet.
Yes.
The only thing, the reason I'm not there yet, I don't have a car, so I can walk it. But I'm not in your area.
Rocco, there's another thing you can do. You can teach the gospel to somebody who has a car, and then you can ride with them together.
Oh, well, the only thing is, see, I called before and had a lot of issues. I said, well, if they don't like me, that's fine. I'll live with whatever their decision is. I'm not perfect, but I'll tell you one thing. God is perfect. And he said, the only thing is forgive those people, because they don't know when they hurt you and when they don't hurt you.
Yes, Rocco, I remember your name now.
And I know I don't have your real address. I do I can go by cab there if it's not where you think, where I think it is.
We're in Woodbridge, Virginia.
Yeah, you told me that, and I thought about that, and I said, I'm wondering if that's near Pepsi Cola, because I've been there a couple of times. A friend of mine rode me up in the canyons. We slept in the open space.
Yes.
And I said, well, as long as the animals don't eat us, I guess we've still got God on our side.
Yes.
I kind of regretted that a little bit.
Do you?
I said, if the animals eat me now, I won't be here much longer.
Yes.
I thought about that, and that's kind of, I'm almost like a chameleon.
Rocco.
I never got, see, God had one thing. He didn't want to be a chameleon, which a lot of people tell me in different churches, if God was a chameleon, we all would be laughing up in heaven.
Rocco, do you have a computer?
No, I don't.
Okay. Do you have a friend who has a computer?
No, I don't. I don't think so.
Okay. Well, if you would like the address for the church, I can give it to you.
You have to send it to me. I do not have any. I can give you my address.
Okay. Would you stay on the line?
Yeah.
Would you stay on the line? And I'm going to have our screener take your address, and yeah, I'll send you that information.
Yes. You're not too far from...
I'm sorry, I lost you for a minute. What did you say?
You're not far from Maryland.
We're quite a ways from Maryland.
And I worship angels because angels saved my life many and many times.
Well, we'll need to talk about that one. I worship Jesus, and the angels serve Jesus. Angels are created beings like you are.
Well, there are a lot of people who didn't appreciate me and as a child, so they're still doing things, fixing my body up.
Rocco, I'm out of time.
Okay.
Stay on the line.
I'll give him their address.
And he'll take the address, okay?
Okay, thank you.
God bless you.
Thank you very much.
Lord, we are out of time for this broadcast, but I'm asking that you would move in Rocco's life and in each person who's been listening today. Lord, it hasn't been the usual broadcast. There's been a gentleness of your spirit that's been present today, and I thank you for that. And I ask in your mercy and in your love that every person today who is in the valley of the shadow of death or in the valley of humility, that you would minister your love and your mercy right now to them. I ask that you would send your spirit and give them the courage to continue, to not give up, to be strong and courageous, to read their scriptures, to pray, to turn aside from sin and to walk before you with humility of heart. Lord, thank you for each dear brother and sister who's on this journey with me. Lord, I thank you. I thank you. Let your name be awesome among us. Send revival to Washington, D.C. Send that hovering presence of your Holy Spirit that will transform sinners and cause them to weep before you and turn from wickedness. Lord, we are a wicked, wicked city like Nineveh. Lord, let the King of Washington, D.C., let the President of America repent, even as the King of Nineveh repented. Lord, have your way. Bring a standard of righteousness, Lord, today in this city, I pray in your holy name. Amen. Our webpage is nationalprayerchapel.com. That's nationalprayerchapel.com. You can find our full address there and where we're located. Come and worship with us on Sunday. We meet at 12 noon at the All Saints Anglican Church at 14851 Gideon Drive, Woodbridge, Virginia. God bless you.
Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy.
Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Lord.